So we will go back to the topics we were talking about this morning. And first of all, I will start commenting the paper by and afterwards, comment your paper, and we will open the floor for discussion. So, in the first place, I would like to give you maybe some news. I don't know if you were aware of this, but in this research center in which I work, a colleague of mine just finished a project in Austria on European integration process, because as far as I understood, this is the first approach to the topic. It's the first time we will get into this question. So, I'm sure you will be interested in getting, I don't know, looking at from a different set of archives. And here we have been researching in the archives of the European Commission, the Council, the Council of Ministers, also the Vienna City Library, mainly for graphic materials, posters, images, also very much linked and interesting from culture, history, and the question of identity. So we can also study from the graphic materials. And also the Austrian State Archives. I'm very specific one, the archive of Kristoffersen Institute, and also the Film Archive in Austria. So we also have videos, documentaries that you can maybe use as some basis of your research for this mission. So I bring you this pressure. And we have about 400 documents for the moment, so that you can base your research on these primary sources and materials. And if you have more questions, we can talk about later. But you will have always different components of these images, photographs, videos, governmental documents from 1945 to nowadays, all about Austria and European integration process. And then, I should say, I found very interesting this relation, this knowledge between the idea that Austrian identity is a European product. So I would like to ask you more about the interactions. How come this Austrian identity is shaped by the birth of European integration? You hint at that, but I would like you to explain in more detail which is the real impact of European integration, of Euro, which are concrete European ingredients of this Austrian identity. That is normally presented, as you explain in your paper, as a more national product, as a product of national history, a more isolated one. So which are the European ingredients and which is the impact, the specific impact of European integration in the building of this process. Then I would like to give you some advice about some methodological aspects and theoretical ones. For example, I want to talk about the relation between Austria and the European integration. I think that when you talk about the relation, you should base it more on two identities rather than in the relation between two entities, rather than the relation between an entity and a process. So it should be better maybe to frame it on the idea of the relation between Austrian and European community, or within the process of European integration. Yeah? So, and then I would like to ask you more about your conceptual framework, because sometimes you mention cultural history approach, a more discourse analysis perspective. Sometimes you turn back to origin of this idea of, as I told you, Austrianization being based on European factors. And I think the most important question to take into account would be for the structure of the paper. I think the premise is very interesting. It's about looking into the European dimension of a member state identity. Would be to set the theoretical framework, then explain the chosen methodology, the relevance of this methodology for the chosen case study, in this case Austria, and explain also the approach you take, which are the contributions you expect to make within this field, and justify it before getting into the content. Because sometimes I have the impression that, I think it's also a question of enthusiasm about the topic, I think you really feel it at the front of it, so you really want to enter in the question before giving all this framework details and justify all these choices. Also, sometimes you make some statements regarding the why the traditional viewpoint regarding this approach is mistaken, another way that you should be taken, but I would like to have more legitimate sources as a base for these statements. So I don't know if I can help you from the basis of this project or this. Yeah, okay. So I mean, we can talk about that later or we can comment it now, but I think it would be a good base because there are different sets of archives in Austria and within European institutions that study precisely the role of Austria, and also it has two different levels to this project. One is the contribution of Austria in terms of European integration. Another one is the impact of the urbanization process in Austria. So it's this bipolar interaction. I hope it will be helpful. Thank you very much for launching this idea and for having the courage of starting in a totally new field, because I am not very specialist in a very different field. So this is very great. I encourage you to. Okay. Now, the reality of liberty, equality, and fraternity. integration and so on, and also the fact that they could be placed in a secondary position, they really ask about this equality. They say, I am French not only when I will be fighting in your wars, as I was before, but I am French also now. I'm part of this French community. So I would like the, if you could explore more or maybe talk us about this idea of instrumental equality as a mechanism of analysis for the implication of these actors. And also I think that another of your very important contribution is the multiplication of the spheres of integration. When we talk about European integration, most of the time we talk about the relationship between member states and the organization of the institutions, the supranational institutions. We also talk about regions, regions would be another sphere. We talk about candidate countries, that would be another sphere. But you seem to go beyond, you need it to a more global dimension, incorporating this idea of colonial implications of, in the process. I'm also very curious about another personal aspect, like the non-aligned countries that you also mentioned in the paper, the non-aligned movement, especially in the 1960s. So which were the relations and the direct interactions between these African representatives and the non-aligned movement? And also, when you mentioned which are the fears towards this coming European integration process, I would like to know which are the preferences or the special considerations towards specific countries. You mentioned, for example, the case of Germany, and this incorrigible Germany, that seems to be always afraid. But what do you say about the other founding member states? I mean, you also mentioned Italy, but you will explain more about the fears and the speculations about the individual member states and not only Europe as a whole. And when these African representatives talk about the fact that they owe not to the colonies, no? I suppose that sometimes they don't believe it. And I don't know if, to what extent we could say this is based on their education in Europe, or this is something instrumental as well. Is something a concession they make, something they use to get more benefits from this French community? This idea of French community, many times made me think about the Commonwealth. So I don't know, could be something potentially interesting for you to maybe do a comparison between the Commonwealth, French community, approaches to European integration from outside, and there's a large problem. I don't know if you want to get into that, but I think something that could potentially bring many answers about this additional sphere of integration that we are really exploring. I consider that Alessandra, the outcome of this conference is going over Eurocentrism. No? This is the first time we will do an affairs conference, and I think this paper will very much contribute to that as well. As I said, it could be a matter of education. We also, as I told you, has an instrumental use of language of the French Republican traditions. So if you could talk more about that, I would be grateful. And also, when we were talking about these representatives expecting to get the same standards of living as those in the metropole, this brought to my mind the idea of cohesion, of European cohesion policy, of cohesion as a principle of European integration. And this is also linked to the conclusion of your paper, which I found fascinating, full of prospects as well, because from cohesion you go to development aid. And I found this very close to the case of Latin America, that we'll also be talking about tomorrow. Latin American countries were expected, especially since the Spanish accession, to have a kind of advocate to get more development aid. And that was the case with France, as you were examining. They were go from development aid to cooperation as equal partners. So we see the itinerary. We have the expectation for cohesion, the expectation of being incorporated in a more massive and comprehensive development aid policy to end up being equal partners in terms of cooperation. So I acknowledge how to support the cooperation side of this. This evolution, I think, is something that, of course, comes later on, and it's too soon to think about this development. And looking on the current developments, I think we want to touch this issue. And I like very much also the fact that these representatives talk about Europe as a competitor more than as a savior, and in a very reversal term. That reminds me of this Ortega Gasset philosopher, Spanish philosopher, statement saying that Spain is the problem, Europe is the solution. So for them, we see that French was the solution and Europe could be the problem. It's more or less the other way around. And how this has to do also, how this changes with this development in this location. Is Europe more and more becoming the solution in France? Not that much of an advocate, France, not that much as a supporter of the university. Of course, with that, a very important transitional moment, you concentrate on the moment before decolonization, but you also touch upon decolonization. And you know, this is fascinating because it opens up the identity transformation issue. Identity itself, assumption of identity, totally changes with decolonization. So I imagine that these people who have been educated in Europe, who have been supporting these policies, either because of party politics, as you say, development expectations, and so on, radically change. And we talk about different parameters of identity, even not something that you should testify that you are also French, you are just African. And that's most important thing you can do. And it's a real thing. So in this turning point, in this moment of real potentiality, which is the trigger of this identity change, and how is it formulated? Is it formulated by the same actors? Which is the actual change of the limits from the colonial participation of the Republican politics to the Union Republic's political representativity. Who are the leaders? Where were they educated? Which are the principles that they state they believe in? So I'd like to explain more about this. And also, the question of racial hierarchy that is so important in colonial politics, and how this could lead us back to the idea of an European hierarchy and the idea of imperialism again. Did the idea of European integration bring also a fear of a revival of imperialism? Was there a formulation of this view in which terms? And I found also very interesting the process of further developing this French Union. So I guess they were thinking in terms of more political integration, more profound cohesion, as we said before, and how this European integration movement could lure the presence of these representatives. So also, I think in terms of identity, before the colonization, it was maybe an opportunity to reconsider how this identity would be learned before maybe becoming the leaders of a new identity with the colonization. Then, also the concept of disguised new colonialism. By inviting these people to be part of politics, they were also, and by choosing the leaders who were closer to the principles, they were also preventing other kinds of movements. So I found very important to talk about that. And I would like, maybe it would be aligned for the moment, your paper, this disguise, new colonialism, were also these realizations that the representative makes of this paternal gaze, where they use it as a discursive point of convergence to speak the same language as the French authorities, just to get something from that dialogue, or was it something so assumed, so culturally assumed, that it was taken for granted? And I imagine that one of the reactions to this was the consideration that they were ends, not means, that something else. I found this really strong, really not this statement. So for me, it's really one of the first decolonization statements in the sources of the literature, and we are ending with the means as we can do it. And
yes, that's the purpose as that.
And I was also shocked by even more strong, stronger statements about saying that we Union, you know, so to what extent did they really have a deterrence power? Could they really blame the French authorities, which were the potential objects or instruments for this political blackmail? Did they really have the power to do that, or was maybe a political strategy? Also, I would like to know which are the basis of your cognitive analysis. If you say that more than going on an quantitative one, you would like to develop a qualitative analysis, so I have that question, which are the theoretical basis for this qualitative analysis. And then say that, as you explained in the beginning, and also something very similar to Peter's paper, this is the first approach. Like the first approach and very well implemented. And of course, it's totally right to start by using these secondary sources. But I was just missing the quotes. And you were quoting them, but you were not giving the references. So it would have been I would have thought only missing within the paper the sense reference, you know, the secondary materials. It's okay, I'll just read to you. You will get more into the documentation and the software I have. And finally, I would like to ask you, how do you think globally that Africa, which role do you think Africa played as an actor, as an overall actor in this process of European integration? How do you think that, which are the possible decisions, as I told you, something that I feel is being really neglected in the past, it should be developed. So these are my questions and my comments for you, and I hope they were useful. We can talk with more time. And now I would like to open the floor to other questions, so please go ahead.
In Eastern Europe at the end of the partition of Europe. And so one question that I sort of vaguely remember being debated in the public arena at the time, and I wonder whether, to what extent, for instance, the Austrian used this possible different registers in constructing their own identities of Europe, but also in presenting themselves to European community. That is, Austria could have been a bridge towards Eastern Europe in a moment in which.
Actually, it was a bridge.
No, I know it was a bridge, but I'm saying, did they choose primarily this option of presenting themselves as a useful, promising bridge to an Eastern Europe that was getting into such a process of change? But also, Austria could be conceived as a sort of barrier against, for instance, migration, the Eastern so-called invasion of Western Europe, which in the 90s was very much an issue. And I was wondering which of the two registers, if you are already working on this, the Austrian specifically decided to stress, to emphasize, to use in order to construct the image vis-a-vis the Union. Brian, I don't know if I'm picking on something that might be lateral in your research or not, but it seems to me that there is something potentially extremely interesting there in this sample of people that you have that can, because they are not only from the colonial world, but they're also particularly informed and within the European debate as well. They are, it seems to me, an extraordinary sample to test and study the sort of global perception image of Europe and of Europe in the main, in the sense of the European community. Because after all, what you said at a certain point is really striking. We're talking about people discussing Europe and the French Union in a moment that is more or less framed by the Indian flu and Algerian war to come. And yet they say the real danger is the European name, is not French colonialism per se, which is, you know, like the self-image of Europe turns upside down. Now Europe, post-war, dissolves its murderous past and goes on to become a sort of post-imperial and even anti-imperial new power in the global world, is here seen from a completely different angle, actually as the potential danger. The white man, the European man, whether it's integrated or not integrated, that's what they seem to be afraid of, more than the institutional man and professional organization that were actually in place. And this seems to me is extremely interesting, exactly because you're not talking about sort of marginal and radicals, you're talking about some of the best informed leaders of this country. So it seems to me a sample of people that are thinking that you should use as deep as possible to investigate the outside perception of Europe and of a Europe that appears, you know, year lights distant from the self-perceptions of Europeans at the time.
I also have a question along the lines of the way you were handled. It was a question he posed to you more directly, or last time you didn't respond, so I will cross you here. These guys, were they or not in favor of independence? Because from everything you said, they were against independence. Because it's theoretically impossible to be, at the same time, to have a representation in the parliaments of a foreign country and to want your own independence. So they were against independence. There's no doubt about that from what you said. So, so that leads to the question of Christine. I mean, these guys, how much do they represent the political elites in the emerging third world countries, even found out that these guys supported basically the creation of these institutions. And then you ask yourself this paradox, because how is it possible these guys at the same time they sort of fear Europe as something that might alienate France from its colonial empire, but they vote in favor of. So I ask for you an explanation of this and what your opinion. I wouldn't be surprised on the fact that if you went to the votes on the European Defense Community, you would find that they were against it, and that nobody at the time thought in reality that they were creating a political union, Europe, nor when the European Court Street, European Steel, whatever the name is, having this colon steel community was signed, not even when the Eurozone was conceived, and certainly not when the Council of Europe was created. So they don't actually fear it, because that's not what the point of these dreams was. It was not about creating a, at least that's my personal and personalistic opinion on it. These dreams were not about creating a political union. They were about creating something rather different.
Thank you very much.
We'll
continue afterwards. Now, if you want to answer.
The first question was about 2 years of my. I think those years could form something like a half on the rating of the relationship between Austria and the European integration, if you wanted to tell it, between those two entities. And I think Austrian identity is in danger by these years, so the form kind of the raw material to form something like a European Austrian half on the rating. So actually, the relationship between Austria and the European Union or the European integration process can be told by referring to those years. The same thing is the point of this. So if you search
can for... Merge. You have to be separated, and it's European necessarily something which is in contrast to Austria.
I think it is in flux. It's going together, I think.
Yeah, that's why if they go together, they don't necessarily need to be based on opposite dates, like different processes.
Yes, but there are two configurations, the Austrian one and the Austrian European one, and so you have to make a certain difference between them.
Can you say which are the main characteristics of Austrian identity and which are the main ones of European identity in your analysis?
Okay, Austrian identity is based, first of all, I think, on the separation of Germany and Europe's East, and it's based on Catholicism, it's based on social partnership, and it's based on the consensus against national socialism, I think, that are the main characteristics of Austrian identity. European identity, it's a very good question.
Yes, in your perception, how do you define it?
I think European identity is everywhere where people say that they're European. So actually, I think there's no essentialist definition of European identity. Okay. So the second question was about 1989. You were talking about, and I think the most important point here is that European and Austrian identity is formed to separate themselves from the European East. So Austrian identity is about to separate themselves from Germany, to separate ourselves from the European East. So something like the East of the continent forms the other in which we can recognize ourselves. That is just.
But is it sort of constructed, if not expressed, in the sense that Europe stops at Austria, then after Austria, Eastward, it's no longer Europe.
You can't have it like that.
First, thank you so much for your very, very, very helpful comments. I think they're going to really help me conceptualize this looking forward. And actually, I have a whole bunch of stuff. So I'm going to go through all of it, but I'm really happy to have it. It's wonderful. It's going to really help me get things on this through. First, I think I'm going to try to briefly address the Giuliano's comments before moving on to yours. And also, was there, I don't think it was a direct question, right?
It was, no, it was a short
endorsement. Oh, thank you. And that's sort of what I took out of it. That was a direct question you wanted me to specifically address. So great. Were they not forward? And this plays into some of the other things. One of the problems I have so far is the voices that I have are of, not only do we have here a elite, right, from colonial society that's in the assembly, but the words that I have, because these are floor debates and not committee debates that I have here. I went through the Foreign Affairs Committee debates and I couldn't find anything really on this. So the debates are going to be in the missing on the that's where I would get this stuff, but I don't have those documents. So I have isolated comments, and this goes along with the secondary sources. I had to go to some of the secondary supplement that I just don't have all the material yet. So I have much, not only is it a colonial elite, but it's the leaders of that colonial elite who I have no statements from. So therefore, I can't necessarily say this is representative of the whole group. It is certainly the case that, and this is related to some things you were mentioning, Kristina, that not only is they're very different from, there's an independence movement that springs up in the late 1950s in these territories. It's certainly inspired by the Mbantu, Algeria, right? It's an African identity, right? And for the most part, the outcome of this in Senegal and in the Ivory Coast is that the elites who were the colonial elites in Paris become the governing elites in their territories and suppress trade union movements this is generalization. I can't speak in too much detail. I don't know enough to speak in too much detail about each country at this moment. Suppress the people who were pushing the independence debate. Also, I think that this plays into the development assistance. I haven't worked at all this out. That I took something from the historian Erwin Wall, who wrote about how France was able to use its weakness in its political instability to pressure the U.S. administration in order to advance its political goals in the 1940s. So they can actually use your weakness. Perhaps this is an obvious thing, but it really helped me to clarify this. And I think this is also the case here, that the pressure that, of course, we see this in politics all the time, the pressure from the street that was growing in the late 1950s would have strengthened their hands in some respects, right? You already have it moving towards autonomy. The same administration that signs the treaties of Rome, Malay's socialist government, there's a mayor of Say, or Stone de Fer, has something called a law cat. Basically, they're just decreeing someone undemocratically more democracy for the president of San Francisco. Not putting it before the assembly, because some of it probably won't be passed. Part of this was because of the spiraling financial demands, which I focused on in the paper and didn't report here. And this is Hooper and Shaker's thesis, that it was just becoming too expensive. You can't bring all these people up to the French literary standard without breaking the bank. And with all the wars France was running, and also the social legislation, yes, under Malay's administration was extremely expensive. And that to the wars, and it's an unsustainable situation.
Okay. the enlargement of quality is, like I say, yeah, I can think about it a bit more. But it comes to this essential issue that I don't resolve on the paper because I'm not in a position to, which is how much of this is instrumentality, how much of this is principle, right? How much of this is them reproducing the rhetoric in order to get what they want? Of course, they're both at the same time. There's going to be a degree of it being both. This would have to get me into detailed studies of these personalities, which I have done. So that's sort of the next step. But a lot of this can help me move with that. And this is one of the, this is a thing about politics generally. I don't think it's been too much, but often, right, when you listen to politicians, they didn't mean what they say, and all this type of, this is a very peculiar situation these are in. Some of them choose to stay in France after decolonization, and die perhaps decades later. So that does give an idea. I don't want to generalize from a few of their cases and say that they're representative of the group.
Okay, maybe more intuitive things. Should see my notes there.
The moving into the 1960s, the non-aligned movement, and the development assistance, and the new relationship that's forged, I hinted at it in the paper, and I think that this is one of the reasons why this topic for me would be particularly interesting, that I know so little about it, that I tried to only hint at it and not make claims that would. So this is research I have to do for moving forward with the project. And the last thing I'll go briefly is the genesis of it, and then I'll probably give you guys a look. I don't know if I would have come up with this written it if I had some prompt, like I said. I came up with it. It has a deeper origin, which is there's a professor at a university who focuses on imperialism and pushing me to consider more deeply the relationship between external imperialism and internal imperialism within Europe. That's one of the things he pushes in his imperialism course. He basically was able to burrow his way into my head, and I think this project in large part is an outcome of that. In addition to the fact that I've read a few things, enough to be able to begin with those rituals after it. Once the idea came, it seemed pretty natural, and then I was just hoping somebody hadn't written 800 pages on it yet, and I hadn't found that. But thank you so much.
Thank you very much.